Broadcasting live from Detroit, Michigan, and all around the world, the Church Militant is Mike. Here's your host, Michael Morris.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Mic'd Up on this All Hallows Eve, where we Catholics actually have the holiday correct. We have the holiday correct in understanding that this isn't the time to put on funny masks and walk around screaming and carrying people, scaring and yelling. It's all about taking the eve before All Saints Day when we celebrate a communion of saints with those who have achieved their perfection, the just who have achieved their perfection in heaven. And the next day, of course, followed by November 2nd is All Souls Day. So that's another wonderful experience for us. Before we begin tonight, I just want to give you a little clue what we're going to be talking about. You've seen the show promoted on with regard to hell. Well, we've got a lot of stuff to show you on hell tonight to talk about and the afterlife and everything. Do you believe in hell? Yes or no? If you'd like to call in and say, yeah, you do, or no, you don't, or you're not sure, the number to call in is 646-200-0903, 646-200-0903. If you're watching on Blog Talk Radio, just click that little Skype button if you have a Skype account. That'll dial you right in if you want to dial on the phone. Again, 646-200-0903. And if you believe in hell or if you don't believe in hell, what does that have to do with the election? Will that influence your vote? Will you vote for president or senator or any other number of things based on your belief in hell? Let's talk about the latest election news real quick, because quick little announcement. Next week, we will not be here on Wednesday night. We will be here next Thursday night, not 1 week. We're taking a one-night break to let all the dust settle from the election, see what happens. We'll be here Thursday night next week, not Wednesday night. So it'll be 2 days after the election. Okay, so we're talking about the election, and it's a dead heat, no doubt about it. We have a funny situation developing, however. All of the polls are showing a dead heat. The battleground states have expanded, which isn't good for Obama, but it doesn't mean just because they've moved from being certain for him to being uncertain for him. That doesn't mean he's going to lose them. That just means that he's lost enough of a comfortable margin. And it is not the case. It is not necessarily the case in politics at all that just because you lose some of your pad, that you keep losing it right up to election day and then you lose it. That the idea of momentum in politics is a totally overblown idea. The trend is only the trend if it continues. So right now, it's like, you know, we likened this at 3 or 4 weeks ago to Obama having a 17-point lead in the fourth quarter. 2 weeks ago, it got down to a 10-point lead. Right now, you'd say it's down to a field goal. But he still has the lead. So there's two aspects here that are contradictory. One is that Obama's, the polls don't show Romney ever picking up steam and getting ahead. There was one poll from Scott Rasmussen who said that Romney had a 2-point lead in Ohio. That's it. We've never seen a poll still. 1 week later, we've never seen a poll saying that Romney's ahead in Ohio. We've seen a couple that say it's a tie, but he hasn't been ahead except in that one poll the entire year. So that's important to remember. But against all of that, there's a few things you have to balance on the other side. Number one, when a candidate has 50% or more in the Gallup poll and other major polls for an extended period of time before the election, well, it has never, get this, never been the case that the candidate that has 50% or more has ever lost. Mitt Romney is sitting on a 14-day lead of 50% or greater in the national polls and the polling average. Number two, when a president's favorability rating is below 50%, that's generally the number he ends up with as the popular vote. If that popular vote translates over into the Electoral College battleground states, he'll lose. Number three, when you look at questions like what's the condition of the economy, when a vast majority of people are pointing to that in a negative fashion, always bad for the incumbent. One very telling question that's always been a bellwether of how the national vote will go, and again, the national vote, while not married to the Electoral College vote, isn't so far off that you have, you know, 30% one way and 20% the other. I mean, it's always within a couple of points of each other. You think about the 2000 election where Bush won the Electoral College vote, but Gore won the popular vote. They were only off by less than 0.5%. I mean, it's not like this is wide disparagence. One very big bellwether question is the direction of the country. Is the country on the wrong track or the right track? Generally, when a majority, meaning a majority of 60% or more, say that the country is on the wrong track, that spells defeat for the incumbent. So, as old-time political junkies and sort of, you know, amateur, semi-pro folks like me and others sit around looking at this stuff, we say, wow, you got a set of polls that really don't seem to tell you anything except it's really close, but you've got all these other indicators saying that in any other race, at any other time, in anywhere in American history, the incumbent has lost. We're going to make a prediction at the end of this show, and one of my cameramen, Matt over there, is looking at me like, are you serious? You're going to make, yeah, I'm going to go out on a limb, Matthew. Show Matthew over there being just, you know, bedazzled at the fact I'm going to go out on a limb. We're going to go out on a limb. We're going to make a prediction. Are the polls right? Or are all the leading indicators right? We'll say that at the end of the show, as long as you guys remind me to say make the prediction. Anyway, so that's the latest election news. We're going to get into what that has to do with hell a little bit later. But right now, it is Halloween, like we said. And what does Martin Luther have to do with Halloween? Well, if you saw a Vortex episode a couple of days ago, you will notice that we sort of pegged and associated Halloween with Martin Luther because he did. The Eve of All Hallows has been a feast day in the church since about the 6th century, and it was moved to October 31st, and I believe the 11th or the 12th century. So it's been around forever. So when Martin Luther challenged the church and supposedly pounded his 95 theses on the door of the Wittenberg Cathedral, he did that on Halloween. Now, let's dispel a rumor here right away. You see all these great paintings and etchings showing the brave young Augustinian friar, you know, demanding justice, standing there in the howling wind with his habit blowing, bravely hammering the 95 theses into onto the door of the cathedral. That's a lot of Hollywood dramatic bunk. It was a university town, and next to the cathedral, there was a big board, like a community bulletin board, where if you've ever been to a college, a university, where the student union is, you see those boards up in the student unions where people stick up, you know, little, they, you know, I need a ride home, anybody want to trade textbooks, I'm looking for a roommate, all that kind of stuff. That's the same kind of board this was. He simply tacked up his things and said he'd like to have a debate about them, and nobody took him on. That's the great story behind hammering the 95 thesis onto the door at the Wittenberg Cathedral. So, anyway, we'd like to move on now and just say, this isn't a good celebration, by the way, Martin Luther and Halloween. As a matter of fact, just into the newsroom here was that Catholic bishops in Germany have been invited by the Lutheran community to celebrate the 500th anniversary of the so-called Reformation, what Catholics lovingly refer to as the Protestant Revolt. The 500th anniversary of that is in 2017, in 5 years. And quite frankly, some of the German bishops, Catholic bishops, are sort of scratching their heads. And here's the article we have here says that the Bishop of Magdeburg, who heads an ecumenical affairs committee for the German Bishops' Conference, pointed out that the 500th anniversary observance will commemorate a tragic division in Christianity. And so it does. And Catholics, quote, do not think they can celebrate this merrily. So the idea of, you don't celebrate division unless it's a division between good and evil. So moving on now, we're talking about bishops here. In the election, we're seeing a lot more Catholic bishops kind of come to the fore in this election in the United States, saying things a little more boldly and declaratively than they have done in the past. Some of you may remember a couple of weeks ago, we did a story in the Vortex on Bishop Lennon and the Diocese of Cleveland, Ohio, and that there were pro-Obama workers inside the chancery there going out to Catholic parishes, instructing people on how to vote according to the faithful citizenship documents. When they made no bones at all about the fact that they were heavy Obama supporters and that sort of thing. Well, the bishop, in the middle of all of this uproar, was finally forced to issue a kind of a clarification. And I'm going to read to you what he said in this clarification that's being inserted into the parish bulletins because of the uproar by faithful Catholics. This is part of what it's going to say in this insert. Quote, to suggest that all issues are of equal value is not what the bishops have taught. Bishop Lennon also wants to go on, Bishop Lennon of Cleveland, Ohio, this is, goes on to say that the difference between issues is one that enhance human life, such as immigration policy, and those which admit to the legitimacy of different approaches to those enhancement questions versus the essential and foundational issues like abortion, euthanasia, and et cetera, which can never be compromised. So the idea that poverty is on the same footing as, or immigration policy is on the same footing as abortion or something like that, Bishop Lennon, thank you, Bishop Lennon, and for all the Catholics in Cleveland who worked hard to make this clear, they are not of the same. They are not of the same rank. Life always outweighs all the rest of it. We're going to take a call real quick from Diane in Hamilton, Ohio, who tells us that Romney is winning in Ohio. Is that what you're here to say, Diane? How are you? Good evening.
Hi, Michael. Thank you for taking my call. I don't know if he's winning or not, but apparently by the Marion Star and the Blaze have reported the machines here in Ohio, even if you vote for Mitt Romney, are voting for Obama. So you have to be really careful, and apparently it's being looked into by government here. But, so I'm not sure who's winning, I can't see Obama.
Diana, excuse me, are you talking about early voting?
Yes, we can do a month early voting here, which is just totally ridiculous. It doesn't take a month to get to the polls. I mean, even if you walk. I mean, I live in the country, and it would only take me maybe a half an hour to walk to my poll, which takes me 10 minutes to drive there. So that's just ridiculous.
Okay, so are you saying there's local media reports saying the machines have been tampered with, and there's voter fraud and all that?
Exactly, and we have electronic machines here where a lot of people still have the paper, which there's problems with that, but it's not as easily accessible as electronics that can be hacked. So, there's definitely problems here.
What county is Hamilton in?
I am in Butler County, Ohio.
Which is it's a Cleveland suburb, right?
No. I'm just right outside of Cincinnati.
Oh, Hamilton. All right. Sorry. Okay. All right. So you are, Hamilton has generally voted Republican, correct? I mean, not strongly, but generally voted Republican, right?
Exactly. We're a very conservative area out here.
Yeah, you kind of contrast with the, you're in the Southwest, you contrast with Cleveland in the Northeast, which is that sort of northern I-80 corridor that generally votes Democratic.
Right, we call that the dark area. The birds fly upside down over there.
Right on Lake Erie. All right, well, Diane,
one more thing I wanted to ask you, and I know St. Michael's is your patron, and he is also in my heart. Would you please, at the end of the show, ask everyone to pray the St. Michael prayer?
Absolutely.
Thank you, guys, can you
remind me of that, Matt? Thank you. All right, we'll make a note. Matt's making a note in the booth there to remind me of that. So,
thank you very much for your call, Diana.
I appreciate it. God bless. Keep us in your prayers. Okay, so going back to the, by the way, folks, if you want to call in at 646-200-0903, we're talking about the bishops and the states becoming more committed to sort of stepping out and making this distinction between the non-negotiable issues and the sort of prudential judgment issues, and we're going to get into the question of hell. Are these number of bishops? Well, let's get to it here. Okay, first of all, Bishop Lawrence Brandt in Greensburg, Pennsylvania, says that a Catholic politician who has a quote established pattern of voting in favor of abortion legislation and an established pattern of public rejection of a core teaching of the church is engaged in public cooperation with a grave and moral evil. God bless you, Bishop Brandt, for saying that. The bishop also said he believes that Catholic politicians who continue to receive communion, quote, should be challenged to take ownership of the consequences, listen to this, of a lack of integrity, talk about a blow there, by publicly acknowledging what they do contradicts who they say they are. God bless Bishop Brandt there. He goes on, quote, any individual who says he can advocate for and enable the practice of abortion and claims that he can still be Catholic in good standing has a very serious problem with integrity. Integrity, which any community can ignore only at its own peril. He says politicians who live, and listen to this, such a disintegrated way are a matter of concern not only to Catholics, but to society itself. Bishop Brandt says, good for him, good for him. We're going to revisit a couple of notices here, if you remember. A couple of other bishops in the United States said some things that they, they equated voting for somebody who, they didn't equate it, they came out and said it. Voting for a candidate or a party that supports intrinsic evils places your soul and your eternal life in jeopardy. Now, as many of you know, we're great devotees of Venerable Archbishop Fulton Sheen here. So we're going to play a quote of his with regard to the idea of thinking that the world can exist without the idea of hell. Play the quote.
The basic reason why so many moderns disbelieve in hell is because they disbelieve in freedom and responsibility. The existence of hell is one of the strongest arguments in the world for the reality of freedom. God allows us free choice, and he allows us to have our choice through eternity.
I mean, a very strong point here by Bishop Sheen is that it gets to sort of the philosophical point of, there must be a hell. There must be a hell, because if we have the freedom to choose, if we have that ability sort of baked into who we are, it's in our human essence, our human nature, and yet there's no choice, well then what good is the freedom to choose if you can't have a choice? So there must be a choice. You must have the ability to reject God, or you have no free will. And of course we have a free will. We get judged on our actions and our deeds. It says that multiple times, despite what some Protestant ministers say that all you have to do is believe. Well, our Lord says something very differently multiple times. So hell must exist because you have to have the opportunity to reject God. If you don't have the opportunity to reject God or to choose God, well, then you don't. Then it's, you know, it's giving you the keys to a car for which there's no car. You have to have the ability to choose. So, speaking of the ability to choose and the consequences of those choices, we're going to go back here to Bishop David Ricken of Green Bay, who said the following with regard to how Catholics cast their votes. To vote for some, he said this week, a few days ago, to vote for someone in favor of these positions, that is abortion, euthanasia, embryonic stem cell research, human cloning, and homosexual marriage, he puts in quotes, means that you could be morally complicit with these choices, which are intrinsically evil. And listen to the language. This could put your own soul in jeopardy. That echoes what Bishop Thomas Papraki said from Springfield, Illinois. We highlighted on the show a couple, 3 weeks ago. He said, you need to think and pray very carefully about your vote, because a vote for a candidate who promotes actions or behaviors that are intrinsically evil and gravely sinful makes you morally complicit and places the eternal salvation of your soul in serious jeopardy. God bless those two bishops, Bishop Ricken and Bishop Papraki. Absolutely wonderful for them to come out and say that. We're going to go back to a Bishop Sheen quote here, speaking of bishops, and let him say, in his words, what happens to a state which denies Christ and denies hell, particularly when it comes to organizing ourselves, and in this democracy, we organize ourselves around the vote.
It is just as difficult to make a free nation without judges and prisons as it is to make a free world without judgment and hell. No state constitution could exist for 6 months on the basis of that liberal Christianity which denies that Christ meant what he said when he said, depart from ye, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, which was prepared for the devil and his angels.
To go back over this, when he is saying that a state can't exist, couldn't exist for 6 months, if you take this kind of notion that there's no such thing as hell. If there's no such thing as hell, meaning, as we broke down in the last one, it means you really don't have, first of all, there's no consequences, ultimate consequences to your actions. If there's no such thing as hell, why not murder and kill everybody in sight that you want to if you think you can get away with it? Or you can take the Hitlerian or the Stalinistic approach and say, well, I'm not going to run the risk of actually getting arrested and thrown in jail. I'm just going to like kind of start a little movement, take over the government, and then rule the thing like a dictator. So the idea of there not being a heaven and a hell is, or particularly a hell, just flies in the face of what we understand things to be with regard to final consequences, the what we get due, a sense of justice. There's no sense of justice at the end. Let's think for a moment about, you know, everybody kind of pegs Hitler and says, oh, Hitler this and, oh, you know, the Holocaust and all that. Well, that's true, but it's not like Hitler was getting up every morning and flying to Auschwitz and, shaking the Zyklon B canisters into the gas chambers. He had a network of thousands and thousands and thousands of people that did this. So what about those people? You know, we don't know anything. We don't know the names of most of those guards, any of those camp guys, most of the commandants, you know, either, escaped or, you know, disappeared. The people who sort of ran the day-to-day, the mechanism of the Third Reich. What did they do? What about them? So there's no hell? Where's the sense of justice with these guys? Don't point to Hitler and say the Holocaust. He was just a raving lunatic, which there's lots of raving lunatics. You can go out on the streets of New York and watch them. His lunacy infected a nation, and thousands, hundreds of thousands of people bought into his lunacy and got up every morning and went to the camps, killed Jews, rounded up, escapees, murdered them all, shot them in forests, and went back home that night, sat down, kissed their children, asked them how they did at school, went to bed, got up the next morning, and went and did the same thing again. There's no hell? Really, there's no hell. We're going to take a break right now. When we come back, we're going to take a look at some statistics involving Catholics and what they believe about God, heaven, and hell, and Americans also in particular, and see the sort of great collapse of what's happened with regard to Catholic belief in hell and how that affects the society in general and specifically this election. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
Catholics are born for combat.
And having the right ammunition to defend and learn the faith is easy. Just aim your browser at churchmilitant.tv. Go to our login page and sign up by clicking on the premium member icon. Then you and your family can choose from hundreds of on-demand programs, all for about 33 cents a day.
Become a premium member of churchmilitant.tv today.
All right, folks, if you want to join us again on this conversation, 646-200-0903, 646-200-0903, or if you're on the Blog Talk Radio site, just click on the Skype button if you have a Skype account. Very quickly, in the last year, about a year and a half ago, Gallup did a poll asking people if they believe in God. 92% of people said they did, 7% said they didn't. The 1% said that they had no opinion. That would be the little agnostic crowd over there. They asked further questions, and those further questions were, do you believe in God or a universal spirit? They sort of broke it apart a little bit. Pretty much the same breakdown. 91% said they believed in God or a universal spirit. So when you look at those two numbers, they're so overlapping with each other that you wonder, when people are saying they believe in a God, do they believe in God as a concept or a universal spirit? Yeah, so about 90% of participants responded that yes, they have some sense of the supernatural. How that boils down, however, when you get down into the nitty-gritty is a little bit different. So that does not translate into necessarily a strong religious belief or foundation. Since 1992, a poll that Gallup has taken, the numbers have stayed pretty constant, plateaued out. When you ask the question, how important would you say religion is in your life? very important, fairly important, or not very important. About roughly, well, it was 58% in 1992. It's 55% as of last year, say that religion is very important in their lives. So slightly more than half. So you've got 9 out of 10 Americans saying they believe in God, but or some sort of sense of the supernatural, a deity, a being, a universal spirit, but only 55%, slightly more than half, believe they have some sort of religious interaction with that. Now, so we'll get to the some of the good parts. 81% of people, according to Gallup, say they believe in heaven. 70% say they believe in hell. So while 4 out of 5 say they believe in heaven, only 7 out of 10 say they believe in hell. It doesn't seem like that much of a difference, but not only is that a 10%, I mean, look at the gradation here. 90% of people say they believe in some universal spirit. 80% of people say they believe in heaven. I mean, so you've got this 10% drop-off right there. If they believe in this universal spirit, well, then why don't they believe in heaven? 70% say they believe in hell. You keep seeing this drop-off. So as you get more specific and more focused in the questions and what the questions sort of imply, what they connote, you have more and more people dropping away from the specific thing. 30% of people don't believe in hell. 30% of people don't believe in hell. That's a very interesting response. When you look at the percentage of adult Catholics who are questioned what they, you know, those who believe in heaven and those who believe in hell, the group that believes in heaven far outstrips the group that believes in hell. This is among Catholics. Now, there are varying answers depending on the different age groups, those born before 1943 and those born since 1982. But nonetheless, younger people believe in heaven more than they believe in hell. Older people believe more in heaven than they believe in hell. Hell has become unfashionable. And when you look at the young generation, the people born after 1982, only half of Catholics, adult Catholics in the United States, only half of Catholics born since 1982 believe in hell. When we heard the quote before, I'll read it to you again here, when Bishop Sheen said, "It's just as difficult to make a free nation without judges and prisons as it is to make a free world without judgment and hell." Freedom, by its very definition, implies a judgment and consequences to those judgments. There is a difference, as Bishop Sheen has said once, there's a difference between drinking tea and drinking TNT. There's going to be a difference. And for Catholics in particular, 50% of Catholics born since 1982 don't believe in hell. And for that fact, only 60% of Catholics in that same age group actually believe in heaven. So when you look at the drop-off in young Catholics, I mean, it's devastating. It's devastating about what's happened to the faith. We're going to take a call here from Maria from Fort Myers, Florida, battleground central headquarters, about Obama and gay marriage. Maria, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Very good. What's your point or what's your question?
My question is how to respond to an offensive email that I received from a family member that I don't usually get emails from, and we've kept away from the subject because we know we're so divided. They know what we think, we know what they think, and I just received, you know, this email that's full of propaganda against Romney and comments about Romney against same-sex marriage and all these, just clip after clip that's really offensive. And I want to respond, but I don't know how. And I know that you say that I don't want to be nice, but I don't know how to not, I don't know how to respond.
Well, come up here and we'll show you how to be mean. That's what we do up here. That's what everybody thinks we do up here.
I
I love it.
We don't want to be mean, but we do want to be clear, because people have a right to clarity. What they do with that clarity, hey, that's totally up to them. As our blessed Lord said, you know, you tell them whatever, and you know, it's up to them to decide. Then, if they won't accept the truth, you know, you shake the dust from your feet and you move on. And I think this is something a lot of people get hung up on. A lot of Catholics on this, like, well, you know, I want to say something, and this, you know, if you know the faith, you know, spend whatever time you think you need to explaining to someone what the truth is. If you find a willing ear, continue. If you find somebody who is just resistant to it, for whatever reason, I mean, we're not going to judge their intentions, we have no idea. Maybe they're not ready to accept it in this point in their life. Maybe in this case of the gay marriage thing, that, you know, they've got children who are gay and they're just in some emotional turmoil. Who knows? But the point is, if you're going to spend time just butting heads with somebody who refuses to accept the truth of what you're saying, that's time you are not spending with somebody who is willing to hear the truth and accept it. And is just sort of waiting for you or someone like you to come along and say, and, you know, help enlighten them as to what it is. Just because somebody doesn't agree with the church doesn't mean they disagree. It just means they may not know. They don't understand. They need someone to explain it to them. That's what evangelizing is. But you can't evangelize everybody. You can go out and say what the truth, well, you can in the broad general sense of the word evangelizing, just say the truth to everyone. But, you know, the effect of that, first of all, the effect is done by the Holy Spirit, but to the extent that you're involved in it, say what you need to say and then move on. If the person wants to engage you more to learn more, get on your knees, thank God, say thank you, and then keep pressing on. But since I don't know exactly what the email says, we can't get into all that right now. I mean, if it's just, you know, saying horrible things about Romney. Look, I don't know if the people you're Marie, if the people you're with are Catholics or not Catholic or whatever the case is. If they're Catholic, you know, reference them the appropriate paragraphs from the Catechism, and then move on. They're perfectly free to reject it or accept it, and whichever they do, they'll have the consequences of it. So, just say what it is. If they are not Catholic, well, find the best way you can. To say something. I wouldn't necessarily get into all the politics of it, because, you know, people have chosen sides, and, you know, the Catholics in America in a week from now, less than a week from now, all the political discussion is going to come to a halt, and we're going to be right back where we are, which is always talking about the faith. So that's the most important thing. Don't talk about it in terms of politics. Talk about it in terms of faith. I hope that's helpful for you. We're going to move on now. Thank you very much for calling in. We're going to move on here and have a... play a little quote from Bishop Sheen about saints and hell and what they believed.
Have you ever noticed that saints fear hell but never deny it? And that great sinners deny hell, but they do not fear it, at least for the moment. The devil is never so strong as when he gets a man to deny there is a devil.
You will never find anywhere, in Catholic tradition, that all of the saints had a great, great respect for hell, for the fear that they would go to hell. St. Paul says, work out your salvation in fear and trembling. And while we're talking about saints, we have a caller, young fellow from South Korea, on the line. Are you there, Thomas? Thomas Lee, right?
Yep.
All right, Thomas, you're going to have to turn down whatever you're listening to us on, whether it's a computer or a phone or something. You're going to have to step away from the speaker because we're getting feedback.
Okay, my question is, how can I be a saint? Because I heard that, you know, only saints go to heaven, so I don't want to go to hell.
Well, that's a very good question. You're 12, Thomas, is that right?
No, I'm 10. I'm 10. In Korean.
You're 10? you're 10 in Korean age?
Yeah, because I'm in South Korea.
All right, and so all right. Well, you're the. Is there a difference? Do Koreans count age? I'm just curious. Do Koreans count age differently?
Differently.
Yeah.
So in America, in American years, how old are you?
Nine.
You're 9 years old in American years?
Yeah. Yep.
Wow. Well, this is the most profound question I think I've ever heard from a 9-year-old. How do you be a saint? Well, the very fact that you're asking that question means I should ask you how to be a saint. If you're, well, thanks very much, first of all, Thomas, for calling in. If you are, I mean, what's the call to be a saint? What does every saint have, regardless of their circumstances, regardless of, you know, their age, their location, their time in history? What does every saint have? A love for God, and not just this sort of generic love, but an actual, real, honest-to-God love for God, where I think a lot of people come to the Catholic faith as, oh, look at all these rules, look at this list of rules. Well, that's kind of an immature, I mean, it's kind of an okay way to begin thinking about it, but it's an immature approach after a while. I mean, there are certain rules, for example, when you're in love and you're married, right? There's certain rules, if you want to think of them that way. You know, you just don't, you know, when you're married, you just don't stay out all night or show up 10 hours late from coming home from work and not have called your husband or your wife and said, hey, I'm going to be 10 hours late. So you could say, well, you know, that's a rule, but the sense of it being a rule sort of gives way to, this is how you relate to each other when you love someone. So, you know, we don't go to Mass because it's a rule. We go to Mass because it is how we express our love for God. But people who are either weak in faith or don't understand it sort of see this as just this kind of obligation, and you just have to kind of go because that's what you do, and if you don't, you get in trouble. That's a very immature way. I mean, if you think of that, take that that understanding and apply it to any other type of relationship, I mean, the relationship would fall apart because you're not getting to the core of it. So how you be a saint, how any of us becomes a saint, is to love God, which is why he says love, you know, the first commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And that means everything in us has to be directed toward God, even our doubts, not about him, but our doubts about, am I doing the will of God? Am I doing what you want me to do, God? You know, our joys. You know, my spiritual director is always telling me about the importance of mental prayer. And I was very confounded by mental prayer. Like, well, you know, what is that? Just like saying the rosary without moving your lips? I mean, what mental prayer? What do you mean by mental prayer? And he said, and it really brought it home to me, he said very plainly, he said, well, look, when you're with friends and you're hanging around, you're talking, and you're just saying things and you're telling them jokes, and even if they've heard the jokes before, what are you doing? You're spending time with them. What are we going to say to God that God doesn't already know? So, yeah, we just go to God and say, you know, so engage in mental prayer and just say, well, Jesus, you know, my computer doesn't work very well today again, you know, and it's kind of funny. We're sitting here in a computer-driven apostolate, and I'm like the worst person on earth dealing with computers. And now, granted, that's not the most deep theological thought at all, but what does it do? It connects me to God. I'm always thinking about God. I'm telling him my troubles. It was interesting when our Blessed Mother came to the three children in Fatima. They were talking to her, and I believe it was Francisco. I'm not sure. It was Jacinto or Francisco. I'm not sure which one. Started telling the Mother of God, the Queen of Heaven, was sitting there explaining to her about some issue with the cows in the field. And she wanted to know. She was asking them, carrying on a conversation about the cows. So, you know, we oftentimes think of God in these big grandiose terms, and that's, we should think of him in those terms, but not to the exclusion of a wonderful, intimate relationship. You know, when the apostles asked our blessed Lord, you know, teach us how to pray, you know, Daddy, Daddy, who art in heaven. We relate to God in such that way that, you know, we'll tell him everything. You know, when we were little boys, I mean, you're a little boy, Thomas, you go to your daddy or to your grandpa and you know, say, hey, I found this little worm and here it is on the stick or whatever. And, you know, it's not the point that God cares, you know, or in my case, that God cares that I can't stand computers because they're constantly failing whenever I walk by them. What he cares about is that I'm sharing that with him. Now, I don't think he wants the relationship to stay on that level, but he cares that I want that kind of intimate relationship with him. All of the saints had this wonderful, very basic, loving relationship. Even St. Teresa of Avila, you know, she had this horrible storm and she was traveling from one part of the country to another and she fell out of the carriage and it was raining and the wheel fell off and she fell into this big old plop of mud and she had her habit on. And she just says, well, if this is, she said to God, if this is how you treat your friends, no wonder you have so few. It, look at all of these different, it's always this intimacy. It's always this intimacy. It's never an over-familiarity, but it's always this intimacy with God. And that's what heaven is. So can heaven begin here on earth? Absolutely, it can begin here on earth. You know, we're not perfected here. That's what heaven is. But the sense of this great great desire to want to be with God and just be involved with him on every single level. You know, in the after you've said grace and you're chewing on your Big Mac or something, say to Jesus, although Phil over here on our research team is going to about go crazy that I said Big Mac, as he's like Mr. Health Man. You know, you just say, oh, Jesus, this Big Mac is, I said grace, but, you know, I just want to let you know that it tastes really good, or in Phil's case, it tastes really bad. But, you know, when you think about, you know, an intimacy with God, this is what sainthood is. Don't think of it in terms of boxes and that sort of thing and, you know, categories. What is saint? Saint's the English word from sanctus, meaning holy. What is holy God? It's the being in relationship with God in everything we do, walking around, hopping in the car, just saying, Jesus, I love you, have mercy. All of these things that constantly keep you in touch, just like you would be sitting talking to a very close, intimate friend or your father, where you would just say something. Again, they don't really care that you've, you know, necessarily what it is you're telling them. They care that you are telling them anything at all. We're going to take another call here from Barry in Alabama. Barry, how are you?
Taking my call. I had a conversation with the priest this weekend, and he was saying that, he didn't want to be too political, even in the climate of the end. He essentially said, well, if other bishops and priests want to make political statements, that's fine, but I don't want to get too controversial or political in my opinions as a priest. And I was just kind of taken back, just given where we are in the state of the Catholic Church and the government and all, and what would be a proper response to priests or even laity that make these claims?
Well, first of all, thanks for the question, Barry. I don't, you know, look, nobody gets to sit on the sidelines in these kinds of times. You don't get to sit there and just say, well, you know, I don't want to get involved. You are involved, whoever you are. Even if you decide not to act, you're acting. So, to not make a statement, well, what? Why? Why would you not want to make a statement? You have a president and a political party that advances intrinsic evils. And I'm not talking about prudential judgments on how should we, you know, advance or, you know, not promote immigration or immigration reform or undocumented workers or, you know, which program is the best for fighting poverty here, there, or whatever. Those aren't questions of intrinsic evil. Butchering children in the womb is a question of intrinsic evil. Killing old people, injecting stuff into them, into their veins to kill them, starving them to death. These are all questions of intrinsic evil. Why on earth would you not want to say something about that? You have to be involved in something like that. And if you, and if somebody, a priest or anybody, is seeing that in terms of a some kind of, you know, I don't want to get involved, of course you want to be involved. How can you not be involved, in that? When you stand up to defend the truth, that's why we're baptized. That's why we're breathing. It's the whole purpose. It's how we get to heaven, to not become involved in the greatest questions of our time. You know, I would turn around and ask them, well, let me ask you, if this was 1854, what would you be saying about slavery? Would you just say with regard to the abolitionist movement, well, you don't want to be involved, you know, you don't want to be political. You know, if you go back to those things, say they're always like, oh, yeah, and then they'll say, oh, well, that's different. No, it's not different. Matter of fact, abortion, you know, 55 million slaves weren't murdered in the United States, like 55 million children have been murdered in the womb. And, you know, God knows how many others, through abortifacient contraception. So if you take a stand on slavery, well, why wouldn't you take a stand on abortion or these other things? It's, You know, those are the kinds of things that sort of raise red flags in your mind. And I think that's probably why you're calling in also about that. And anybody else listening, I think, would agree. They raise red flags. Why would you not want to stand up and defend the truth? And if you are a priest, why would you not want to stand up and defend the truth? They're very troubling questions, and it's why faithful Catholics are troubled by those kinds of responses. We're going to take a call from John in Massachusetts. John, how are you doing today?
How are you, Mike?
Doing well, thank you.
I call like every week, so you probably know who I am now. But I was listening to you. I can't get you on Blog Talk, so I'm listening to you over the phone, but I just wanted to ask you a question. Well, make a point. First of all, I want to say your Vortex on Hell was fabulous. I mean, we need to hear more of that.
Well, thank you. It's just stringing together what the saints and the doctors and the fathers of the church said.
Exactly. I mean, putting that in there was just like cementing it, and it was great. And we don't hear that anymore, as you well know that. But I wanted to respond to the caller, two callers ago, who said that she got an email, and she was insulted by it. It was against Romney, and she was angry. And she didn't know how to respond to it. And it's funny because are you familiar with Patrick Madrid?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I know him very well.
Yeah, well, I just saw an interview with him today, and he said when he gets a call or he speaks to a person like that, yes, inside he's boiling mad. And this ties in with your silent prayer. He says to himself, okay, Jesus, let me calm down and let me just be charitable and eat. And that's what he has to do, he said. He has to, because sometimes he just wants to explode, but he on his exterior, he's calm, and he's, you know, he will be charitable to the person, because once you get them defensive, they're not going to hear you.
Yeah, I mean, I of course I agree with that. You know, the person has to be in a position where they can be reached. And, you know, you and I know, and, you know, everybody on earth knows that lots of times someone will come up to you and say something along the lines, you know, they'll make a statement and then they put a question mark at the end of it, not really wanting to engage you in a question or a dialogue. They just simply want to make a statement, but so they don't appear like they're in an argument, they'll like ask, you know, sort of make a frame it in the form of a question. But, you know, these are all very case-by-case basis. You know, I agree with what Patrick said. You certainly don't want to, like, jump down somebody's throat. On the other hand, if somebody's jumping down your throat, you know, you got to stand up like a man and defend yourself and, you know, say what things are. And that doesn't mean knock them out, you know, physically. You can certainly knock them out verbally. But, you know, you got to say what the truth is. I mean, it's just, you know, it's just what it is. But, you know, I want to take a break. So we got a little bit off topic here as we ran into some Blog Talk technical issues at the beginning. And the point of this show was to talk about hell and its reality and how that is a long-standing tradition in the Catholic Church, not just that there's a hell, but the reality of actually how few people are saved. We have a number of recordings that we produced here with different staff members reading some information or some quotes from various saints. We're going to play a couple of those for you right now.
We owe God a deep regret of gratitude for the purely gratuitous gift of the true faith with which he has favored us. How many are the infidels, heretics, and schismatic who do not enjoy comparable happiness? The earth is full of them, and they are all lost. St. Alphonsus Maria de Liguori. Not all, nor even majority, are saved. They are indeed many, if regarded by themselves, but they are few in comparison with the far larger number of those who shall be punished with the devil. St. Augustine.
Yeah, do you hear these people, you know, who these are? St. Alphonsus Liguori, founder of the Redemptorist, St. Augustine from the 5th century, probably the greatest mind, I guess Thomas Aquinas and he might be duking it out up in heaven, but one of the greatest minds the Church has ever produced, a doctrine of Father. Here's one from St. Benedict Joseph.
Meditate on the horrors of hell, which will last for eternity because of one easily committed mortal sin. Try hard to be among the few who are chosen. Think of the eternal flames of hell and how few there are that are saved. I was watching souls going down into the abyss as thick and fast as snowflakes falling in the winter mist. St. Benedict Joseph Lebret.
It has been a very long tradition as you read through. We can't read all of them on this show. We assembled, 30, 40, maybe even 50 quotes with barely looking. It took an hour maybe of looking, just saint after saint, doctor and father, of just on and on and on, that so few people are saved. Let me read you one here. St. Alphonsus Liguori again says, "Everyone desires to be saved, but the greater part is lost." Here's one from St. Leonard of Port Maurice. "Look higher still and see the prelates of the Holy Church, pastors who have the charge of souls. Is the number of those who are saved among them greater than the number of those who are damned? Listen to Comte Prey. He will relate an event to you, and you may draw the conclusions. There was a synod being held in Paris, and a great number of prelates and pastors who had the charge of souls were in attendance. The king and princes also came to add luster to that assembly by their presence. A famous preacher was invited to preach. While he was preparing his sermon, a horrible demon appeared to him and said, 'Lay your books aside. If you want to give a sermon that will be useful to these princes and prelates, content yourself with telling them, on our part, the demons, we, the princes of darkness, thank you, princes, prelates, and pastors of souls, that due to your negligence, the greater number of the faithful are damned. Also, we are saving a reward for you in this favor, when you shall be with us in hell.'" St. Leonard of Port Maurice. Here's another quote from him. "Woe to you who command others. If so many are damned by your fault, what will happen to you? If few out of those who are first in the Church of God are saved, what will happen to you? Take all states, both sexes, every condition, husbands, wives, widows, young women, young men, soldiers, merchants, craftsmen, rich and poor, noble and plebeian. What are we to say about all these people who are living so badly?" The following narrative from St. Vincent Ferrer will show you what you may think about it. He relates that an archdeacon in Lyon gave up his charge and retreated into a desert place to do penance, and that he died the same day and hour as St. Bernard. After his death, he appeared to his bishop and said to him, "Know, Monsignor, that at the very hour I passed away, 33,000 people also died. Out of this number, Bernard and myself went up to heaven without delay. Three went to purgatory, and all the others fell into hell." We're going to play another quote here from another saint from the church.
"Shall we all be saved? Shall we go to heaven? Alas, my children, we do not know at all. But I tremble when I see so many souls lost these days. See, they fall into hell as leaves fall from trees at the approach of winter." Saint Jean-Marie Baptiste Vianney.
Patron saint and priest said that. Got about a minute left here. I want to read you one last thing from St. Alphonsus Liguori on the number of people who will be saved. He said, "All persons desire to be saved, but the greater part, because they will not adopt the means of being saved, fall into sin and are lost. In fact, the elect are much fewer than the damned, for the reprobate are much more numerous than the elect." Again, that's from St. Alphonsus Liguori. A absolutely wonderful thing to keep our minds on, fellow Catholics. Elections come and go. Political parties come, empires and civilizations come and go, but the church remains, and what matters at the end of the day is whether you make it to heaven. Doesn't matter what else happens to you. I'd like to close here with a quote from our Holy Father. "The world promises you comfort, but you were not made for comfort. You were made for greatness." The world promises you comfort, but you were not made for comfort. You were made for greatness. We'll see you next week. Listen to you next week on Thursday on Mic'd Up. God bless you all. God bless America.